Hello everybody and welcome to video number 30 of the online version of the Fusion Research Lecture. In the last video we finished with chapter 5, collisional transport, and thus in this video we will start with chapter 6, turbulent transport. So this is a 6 for turbulent transport. Oops. More or less. So actually, although we talked a lot about classical transport and neoclassical transport, when you look in the experiment, you will see that neoclassical effects alone are not sufficient to explain the observed transport in tokamak fusion plasmas. So neoclassical effects are not sufficient to explain the observed transport in tokamak fusion plasmas. The transport is actually 1 to 2 orders of magnitude too small. In classical stellarators, however, this was an agreement. However, modern stellarators are so good that the neoclassical transport losses have been reduced, like W7X, for example, and also turbulent transport is an issue there, because what is going on is turbulent transport, which is used as an explanation for the increased additional losses. So turbulent, sometimes also called anomalous. This is a bit of an unfortunate expression because it might sound weird or strange, and it was just used because it was not normal transport, something which could not be explained in the beginning. So this is why the expression anomalous was used, but in principle it's just turbulent transport. And this is due to small scale fluctuations. So small scale fluctuations, those are the source or the origin for the observed transport. Those are small scale fluctuations in density, in temperature, and also in the plasma potential. If we observe these, then we call this electrostatic turbulence, which is created by the fluctuating electric field. Fluctuating density, fluctuating temperature, fluctuating plasma potential creates a fluctuating electric field, and the resulting E cross B drift then leads to electrostatic turbulence, as we will see. If we have also magnetic fluctuations, just to be clear, if they are not zero, then we talk about electromagnetic turbulence. Then we talk about electromagnetic turbulence. And the electromagnetic turbulence is then caused by micro islands. You remember when we talked about magnetic islands? By micro magnetic islands. And just for a definition, so since I've used these expressions with the tilde on top, so for the density, for example, the full density is the background density and not plus the perturbed density and tilde, where the average value of the density denoted by these brackets is simply a not, which of course implies that the average of the fluctuating part is zero. Okay. As for the outline of this chapter, we will first talk about turbulence in neutral fluids. turbulence in neutral fluids. And we do so just to be sure that we are all on the same page here. I know some of you might have heard a hydrodynamic lecture, but if not, then we just ensure that we all talk about the same things. Then we talk about turbulence in magnetized plasmas. Turbulence in magnetized plasmas. Then we will talk about turbulence observed in the experiment. And then finally, we will talk about methods to suppress or reduce the turbulence. Methods to suppress or reduce the turbulence. Okay, when I start with this chapter, I always, when I start with this chapter, I usually like to start with a quote of these two people. So on the very, on the left-hand side, you can see a photography of Richard Feynman and his quote. He said once that turbulence is one of the most unsolved problems of classical physics. He did not say that literally, but figuratively. And on the right-hand side, you can see a photography of Werner Heisenberg, who was also the founder of IPP in 1960. And he said the following: "When I meet God, I will ask him two questions, why relativity and why turbulence? I really believe he will have an answer for the first." So this is just as a motivation to show you that really great minds in physics, really great people considered the problem of turbulence to be one of the most important ones. So let's talk about turbulence in neutral fluids. Turbulence is observed everywhere in nature. This is probably a good way to start using these pictures here. Turbulence is observed everywhere in nature. When I say everywhere, I mean, for example, in fluids. This is the picture on the left-hand side. So this one here, what you can see there, these are the ocean surface currents deduced from satellite measurements from NASA. And these data was then fed into a computational model. And then you can see in the ocean these kind of currents here, these turbulent structures. So I think this is a very nice graphic there. Then, of course, not only fluids, but it's also in gases. So this photography here, this just shows a bit of smoke coming from a candle. You can see how this is a very nice and turbulent structure. And then on the bottom, of course, you can see this one here. This is a simulation of a plasma, of a magnetized plasma, actually of a D3D plasma. And you can clearly see the turbulence going on here in the poloidal cross section. So it is turbulence is a ubiquitous phenomena in nature. Now, what is turbulence? So turbulence can be defined in multiple ways, and a very simple definition might be the following. So turbulence is or can be understood as flow vortices of different size moving with random motion. So it can be understood as flow vortices. These are also sometimes called eddies of different size and with random motion. This is a very short and simple definition of turbulence, but it captures, I think, the most important or for us relevant properties here. Okay, turbulence has been a hot topic for centuries. A hot topic for centuries. And these hot topics include, for example, the transition or studying the transition from laminar to turbulent flows, from laminar to turbulent flows. Then to study the lifetime of these eddies, to study the lifetime of eddies, to study the distribution of the size of these eddies, to study the distribution of the size of these eddies, to study the size distribution of the energy, and to study the energy input and the energy transfer and also the energy dissipation. So energy input, the energy transfer between the scales, and also how the energy is dissipated. And especially these three topics are also topics of modern physics. And one very important role in turbulence plays the, and in hydrodynamics in general, the Navier-Stokes equation. The Navier-Stokes equation, because this can be used to describe turbulence in incompressible fluids, in incompressible, meaning that the gradient of the velocity is zero, the divergence, in incompressible fluids. And it reads as follows. So we have rho m and then delta t, so this partial derivative with respect to time, and then the velocity times nabla times the velocity, so the hydrodynamic derivative being equal to minus grad p plus rho m times g, the gravitational force, plus eta, and then Laplace times the velocity. So this is the famous Navier-Stokes equation. And here, as I said, we have the pressure. This is pressure. Then this is the gravitation. And then here, this is the friction. Laplace times the velocity. What else? We have rho m. This is the fluid density. Rho m is the fluid density. Then, of course, u, which is the fluid velocity. And finally, eta, the viscosity of the medium. Viscosity. Now, the Navier-Stokes equation is corresponds to, in, or is basically an equation of motion. This is an equation of motion. And it is similar to the corresponding equation in a plasma, to the corresponding equation in a plasma, which reads, just as a reminder, also the fluid, the plasma, well, density rho m, and then dt plus u times Nabla times, oops, sorry, times u being equal to grad p plus rho m times e plus u cross b, so the Lorentz term, and this is quite similar. Now, an important simplification is if we talk about ideal fluids. For ideal fluids, where eta is equal to zero, we get the Euler equation. The Euler equation, often made simplification, because you can already study important phenomena using this equation, the Euler equation. And this then obviously reads rho m times delta t plus u times nabla times u being equal to the gradient of the pressure. Okay, that's it for this video, which was an introduction into chapter 6, turbulent transport. And the major points were that the neoclassical effects are not sufficient to explain the observed transport in the experiments, and the transport being responsible for most of the losses in the experiment in the tokamak is turbulent transport. And in this video, we started to talk about turbulence in neutral fluids. I gave a few examples and a very simple definition of turbulence, which can be understood as flow vortices, eddies of different size with random motion. And on this slide, it was probably mostly a reminder for you, the Navier-Stokes equation, which can be used to describe turbulence in an incompressible fluids, and the Euler equation, which is just setting the viscosity to zero. Okay, that's it for this video. See you in the next video.